We're taking a look at the IP tools that come with the Windows operating systems. And this is our TCPIP Basics course. In our previous video, we looked at ping, ARP, traceroute, and pathping. And in this video, we're going to talk about the other commands that you see on the left-hand side, such as NSLookup. So let's go ahead and type NSLookup. And after you type NSLookup, what you want to do is you want to put the name of a host record just that comes just after that. So let's go ahead and put in google.com, just make it simple, and we'll hit enter. And so here's what it's doing. Here's what you're seeing here is you're first seeing the DNS server that I'm using. I'm using a DNS server on Comcast, and the address is 75 all four times, as you see there. But what it did was it went over to find out what DNS server is actually registering Google.com's host addresses. And we see two different addresses. The first one is an IPv4 address. I should say the bottom one is. And the other one is an IPv6 address. So the IPv6 that you see here is written out in this 2607. So that's hexadecimal. That's why you see some letters and some numbers. However, in the IPv4, we're seeing a traditional IPv4 address. So the information that we're getting is not only what IP address the DNS server is, but it's also telling us that it's a non-authoritative answer, which means that although it is giving us this information, this is not the authoritative server itself. So the authoritative server is the only one that can make a change to a host record. Non-authoritative can broadcast that information, but it can't make that change itself. So if we're using an Active Directory server for our DNS, for instance, then we would see slightly different information. We would see the domain controller rather than the public DNS server. So we use NSLookup or name server lookup to find out what server's actually supplying the name to IP address information. And this can be very useful when you're doing some troubleshooting and you need to go in and find the authoritative server or the broadcast server in this particular case to tell us who is providing that information. Now let's take a look at the route command. In order to route, we can go ahead and type in route, and we can take a look at what our routing table looks like. So we can see here we've got a single route right now, which is our default route out to the internet. So you've got to have at least one default gateway or router to get out to the internet, and you see we have it here. After that, this is all broadcast and other types of information that we just don't need. So you only want to pay attention to the routes themselves that have a gateway. So what we want to do now is we want to create a route to another subnet. Let's say we have other subnets inside our network and we want to be able to route to them, but we don't want them to go out through our firewall because that would take us out to the internet, and that's not where our different subnets are. So we can type in route, and then we type in the word add. Now we want to type in the subnet where we want to go. So let's say we want to go to 10.0.0.0. Next, we have to add in the word mask for the subnet mask. And we'll type in 255.0.0.0. Now we have to add the gateway, but all we have to do is just type the IP address of the gateway itself. And let's just say our gateway router is at 15.100. So since we're on a 15 network, we have to use the gateway as an IP address that is in our current network. So if we add a gateway in another network, such as the 10 network, it's not going to work because the doorway has to be on our side. So in this particular case, the router is at 15.100 on our side, and it's at the 10.network on the other side. So what routers do is they route between different subnets. So that's a perfect example there. So let's go ahead and enter, and we see that we were successful. Let's do another route print and see what it looks like now. So now we see a second gateway address, and we see that the 10 network, we can get to that through the 15.100 IP address. And then we can see our IP address on our interface is still the same, so nothing changed on that. Let's take a look at another route command. And that would be the exact command we just did to add, but we're going to do a slash P. And the reason for the slash P is for persistence. So that would mean that even after we reboot our computer, the route will stick. If we don't do the slash P, then after we reboot our computer, the route will disappear. Now, let's say we changed our minds and we no longer want to have this route, so we're going to manually get rid of it. First, we get rid of the slash p, and then we type in the delete command. And now our route is gone. If we type a route space print, and we can see the only route left is the original default route out to the internet. So that's working fine. Let's go on to the next command, which is going to be netstat. So if we want to do netstat minus an, it gives us some very interesting information. Now it's going to scroll through a lot of stuff. So we want to choose the pipe command and type in more. So you can see the pipe command underneath your backspace key if you're using a US keyboard. The UK keyboard is slightly different. So we'll go ahead and enter. And you can see it goes one page at a time, and it tells us all the different ports that are currently listening for our different TCP ports on our network card. So we can see we're listening on port 135, we're listening on port 445, etc. So these are all TCP ports because we see them over here. Then if we go down a little bit further, we can see there's some UDP ports we're listening on as well. So it gives us all this information. If we have established a communication between our computer and another computer, then you will see established. So we can see from our different commands that we were doing earlier, or possibly some websites we were going to, we can see that we have connected on port 443 to these other IP addresses. So if we wanted to see what IP address that resolves to, we could use the ping minus A, which we discussed in a previous video. So the netstat command gives us a status of the network connections that we have. We don't need to use the minus an. We can just type in netstat, and it'll give us slightly different information. Once again, you want to make sure you use the pipe command. Otherwise, it'll scroll through a lot of information if that information is there. So if we just type in netstat alone, instead of telling us the TCP ports that we're listening on, it tells us just the TCP ports that we're connected to. And it's those same three that we saw earlier. There's lots of other netstat commands that you can take a look at. If we do the slash question mark, we can see all the different switches that come with netstat and all the different things that they do. Let's move on to the IPConfig command. If we type in IPConfig, we hit enter, and we can see that we've got our Ethernet 3 connection. We see our IP address, our subnet mask, and our gateway, and we need all of those in order to get out to the internet. Now, in order to resolve IP addresses, so we have to do names to IP addresses, we need to have a DNS server. Now, we don't see that information if we do just an IPConfig. We need to put in the IPConfig slash all command. Now, we also see the DNS servers here, so we know what we're using to get out to the internet to resolve names to IP addresses. We still see the same information we saw earlier. We see our IP, we see our subnet mask, we see our gateway, but we see a lot of other information as well, such as our lease obtained and expiration date. We also see our other information, such as our Teredo and Isotep interface, which convert IPv6 to IPv4 IP addresses. Let's take a look at a couple of other switches. We see IPConfig slash release, and we also have the renew command. So the release would release our DHCP IP address, and then if we type renew, then it will renew our IP address. We may do this in case we need to get off of our network and back on our network for some reason. There's lots of different reasons why you'd want to do a release and renew. Sometimes we've updated our DHCP scope, sometimes we've updated our DNS server or our gateway, and all that information can be renewed if we do the release and renew, and then the computer will get that new information, which is great. So another switch I'd like to do is the register DNS. Register DNS, what that'll do, and we'll go ahead and hit enter, is it will go ahead, if we have a local DNS server or part of Active Directory, it will register the name and IP address of our computer into the DNS manager. So if we've gotten a whole new IP address, it's a great idea to do the register DNS so it's updated. So what that does is it helps other computers find us and us find other computers. And then the last switch I'd like to talk about is the flush DNS. Let's go ahead and type that in. Flush DNS is great when you have cache on your local computer, which automatically builds up, and that cache is somehow outdated. So let's say there's a new IP address for our server, and we keep trying to connect to the old name server mapped to the old IP address. So if our old IP address was 192.168.15.200, and the new address is .201, then our computer will continually try to connect to the old name to IP address map unless we flush our DNS, and it will, where it will flush the old information and pull the information from the server so that we have the latest information. So that's one of the reasons I use flush DNS. I have used it a lot of times. So that will do it for our IP tools in our TCPIP Basics course. Please check out all the other videos in the playlist to make sure that you are prepared for whatever certification course you're taking or whatever course you're taking in your college or high school. And once again, I'd like to thank you for joining me.